I'm going to go through 7 or 8 interesting things that I have come across. These have not appeared in the field of conventional medicine, but they have appeared in the general area and are really interesting to me. The first is emotional intelligence. This was Daniel Goleman in the 1970s. Emotional intelligence refers to a person's ability to understand their own emotions and those of others. And what is now believed is that this can matter even more than IQ, and that some of the skills can be learned. And in fact, this is very relevant to any kind of team situation where people have to work together. The second interesting study is neuroplasticity. And this was the work of Dr. Richard Davidson, a scientist from the United States, who in 2005 presented his research on the effects of meditation on the brain. Time magazine nominated him as one of the 100 most influential people of the last century, so this work was considered as very important. Dr. Davidson appears to have teamed up with the Dalai Lama, and he was able to access the cooperation of chosen, accomplished Buddhist monks with 15 to 40 years of practice behind them, which represented literally between 10,000 and 50,000 hours of meditation practice. These monks, at will, can put themselves into a different kind of state, and the electrical activity of the brain and blood flow through the brain was studied using methods such as electrophysiology, positron emission scanning, MRI scanning, and so forth. The result of this study was that a new map appeared. There was a possibility of mapping out parts of the brain where particular things happened, and it showed how they seemed to happen as far as people that were practicing meditation. What was shown here was, it was suggested that the brain could actually change. It was previously thought that neurons were fixed and there was no possibility of real change of growth, but this study proved otherwise. The third study has to do with happiness research. This is the work of Dr. Martin Seligman, who in 1998 was elected as president of the American Psychological Association. Now, in the early 2000s, they began to study happiness. All sorts of different studies and work that had been done were on people that were sad or depressed and so forth. But there was not much research being done on what made people feel happy and full of gusto. So they began a scientific study to try and understand this. And the result of this work was published by Dr. Seligman in his book, Authentic Happiness. Time magazine published a leading article in their 7th February 2005 edition called The Biology of Joy, which looked at all the results of this research into happiness, and this article is really interesting to read. The next study is about the faith gene. I came across this again in the Time magazine article of 29th November 2004. The article was called The God Gene, and this referred to the work of biologist Dr. Dean Hammer, working at the National Cancer Institute in America. His work appeared to show that if people possess a gene called VMAT2, this will predispose a person to believe in some sort of higher power. And the question arose, is faith hardwired in people's genes? Dr. Hammer was clear to point out that this did not prove any kind of existence of God. He just pointed to the fact that if you had this gene, you were likely to believe in some sort of higher power, and that was all. Also in this Time magazine article, there was a quiz, a personal inventory of 20 questions with the title, How Spiritual Are You? This article was very interesting, and I certainly found I scored very high on this. The fifth study refers to the chemistry of emotions. This is the work of Dr. Candace Pert, who was a research professor in physiology and biophysics and one of the neuroscientists that discovered endorphins and opiate receptors in the brain. Her work was really to discover the chemistry associated with psychological states, in particular mystical states or states where people experienced highs, as it were. She did produce a book, Why You Feel the Way You Feel, and I think it's quite possible that in fact the basis of all things is chemical, and as it is sometimes put, we are a bunch of chemicals running around in a bag. The sixth study I'll talk about is the work of Abraham Maslow. His work was really phenomenal. He was a motivational psychologist, and he published a book called Motivation and Personality in 1954. And his work, The Hierarchy of Needs, is still in current use. He stated five needs as a hierarchy, which are displayed here on the slide and can be found in all the literature. Later on, this was amended to make five into seven needs. Quite interestingly as well, I came across the work of Wayne Dyer, a well-known American New Age guru, who brought out a DVD called From Ambition to Meaning. And he seemed to suggest that the first early part of our life is devoted to ambition. In other words, making something of ourselves, making a career for ourselves, raising a family and so forth. But the second part of our life is really all about finding meaning. And if there was a difficulty in moving from ambition to meaning, then this would create a situation in life which would need wise resolution or a way of looking at it. In this connection, I remember the standard Vedic stages of life, which were that of a celibate student, a householder, the stage of spiritual search, and a sannyasi. I'd like to speak a little about this, because this is part of the ancient Vedic literature, and it would seem, from what I know, that communities in India, in some instances, still kept to this system until about 150 years ago. At which time it probably vanished completely. The first state was called Brahmachari when a young man was a student or in the first stages of life. He then became a grihastha, a householder. This was about marriage and raising a family. The third part of his life was called Vanaprasharam. This presumably was when the children had flown the nest and a man and his wife, as it were, would try and give up the world and go in search for God. The fourth state, called sannyasi, was really the state of renouncing, where a person was preparing to meet their maker.